Hey guys.
Did you ever wonder, how do I get my own VPS server? Did you? Well, if so, you came to the right place. Because I'm making a video and showing you step by step how to do this. So, let's go. So yeah, in this example I chose to go with a VPS provider called Contabo. And I believe they're located in Germany. Not that that matters, anyways, but it's near where I live, so my order has already been paid and is being processed. Now, I'm actually waiting on the email that contains my login details and the IP address and such. I haven't received it yet. But I did want to show you which VPS I chose and their prices. They're amazingly cheap. I already had one of these running, and now I chose this one. So that's €4.99 per month. And then you get 4 cores, 80 gigabits of RAM, 200 gigabytes SSD drive, and 200 Mbit upload download, unlimited traffic. The rest doesn't really matter. That's not a lot, is it? So that's why I went with this one. So, as soon as I receive the email, I'll continue this video.
So, as you can see here, the order processing has been completed, and I did indeed receive an email from them, which contains my username and password and the IP address I need to log into, the IP address of the server. So, I'll need that to create a new connection using WinSCP. Oof, that reminds me. Please download WinSCP from winscp.net. Continue to please download PuTTY, downloaded from PuTTY.org. Thank you. Let's continue. So we're going to need the IP address. Create a new session in WinSCP. Root. Copy the password. Save. And now we can log in. There we go. Right, I stopped recording after the last scene, so we're now a day later actually. In the meantime, what I did is I created a dynamic hostname at noip.org or .com. So we're going to use that to log in. I already did, as you can see. If you have configured WinSCP correctly, and let me show you how to do that while we're at it. Because you have downloaded PuTTY and WinSCP, first you set up WinSCP, and then PuTTY put it in some folder. I chose this one. And then you have to set it in this window that you see right here. I always enable this one also, so I don't have to type my password every time. And this allows you to open a PuTTY session to the server that you have open in this tab. So there you go. As you can see, I'm now logged in. First, let me change the password, of course. I'm already logged in as root, so just have to type this. Alright, that has been done. Let's first start to update the repositories. So the system knows where to get its software from. It's already up to date. First thing I always do is install a text editor that I like. It's called Joe, but basically it's the same as Nano that most people use these days. Or VIM or whatever. Oh. So I can start editing some configuration files with those. You only need one of them. I prefer Joe, but most of you may be more familiar with Nano. Now, what I want to do first is change the port of the SSH server, where the SSH server is running on. Yeah, so we're going to do that in this file. By default, it's port 22. I'm going to change it to, I don't know, whatever. Anything but 22. We're going to save that. And restart the SSH service. Okay, so edit that. Change to the port you changed into. Connecting so it's online on a different port now than 22. Just for safety reasons, might as well install the firewall now. That's pretty important also. It doesn't enable by default, because that would lock me out of my server. So what I'm going to do is, first, allow myself, allow 2222, TCP. It's inactive. What you can do with UFW is use this command to see what servers are running on your server. and use those names to add the allow rules for it. Yeah, you can see. And what I could do is VFW allow SSH, like that. Might as well. We're going to install a web server, so I might as well already open those ports. You can be more specific. I should actually be more specific at TCP or UDP. I'll be installing Webmin shortly. Also allow a rule for that. And that's it for now. I think I can enable it. Yes. Alrighty. Yeah, there you see the rules. I'll be changing those later on, but this is just to get yourself started. So make sure you make a rule for SSH access for yourself first, before anything. You don't want to lock yourself out, because then you have to do it through the provider and all that stuff. So you don't want to do that. Now, Webmin is something, it's free, and it gives you a lot of tools to manage your server through a web interface. It also has modules, so you can add certain things that other people wrote. For example, an Nginx plugin that allows you to manage and Nginx from the Webmin page. Now I need to update first. This is how you install Webmin. First, add the repository to your system, and then you can just use apt to install it. I might as well install some other things that I think are required. These two allow you to synchronize the internal clock with some external server. And this allows DNS lookups and stuff like that, I believe. Okay, it's taking a second. If you install new services on the server, remember that you have a firewall enabled, so make rules for every app that you want to allow access from the outside. What you can always do if you're tired of waiting is open a second PuTTY session. I'm going to set the host name. Alrighty. Let's check if. Alrighty. Set it here also. I should remove this from the video. I see it's done here, so I can show you Webmin. Of course, you get an error for the certificate, just accept it, continue. I believe logging in as root. Here you can see some lovely statistics. Well, what can you do with this? Everything you want. Manage your users and groups, running processes. Servers, which doesn't mention a lot now, but if you install Apache, it will become an extra option here. MySQL will show up, PostFix, everything will automatically show up once you've installed it. You might have to refresh the modules once, and then it will automatically appear. Yeah, you just look through this yourself, you see there's a lot of handy things in here. First thing I usually do is set the system time, or check the system time, and enable synchronization with some NTP server. Yeah, that's correct. Time zone, that's also good. This is the NTP server that I'll use. Synchronize when Webmin starts, no. Synchronize on schedule, yes. Time to blow, that's good. Sync and apply. Now, if you didn't install NTP date, like we did earlier, you will get an error message here. That was my cat. Thinks he's hungry. Yeah. We're almost done. In fact, we're also almost done. Although I just remembered that we forgot to set a static IP address. Now, in my case, that's not required, not necessary, because I already have a static IP address set by the provider. But if you install the server locally on your own network, then you'll get a local IP address. You might want to set it as static so you can easily forward ports to it if necessary. If you want to set a static IP address, you might as well do that through the Webmin interface that we just installed. It's just as easy. Or else you have to go into the command line again, which is also possible. But yeah, you can look into that yourselves, I assume, how to do that. And else you can just use this network configuration part here. So yeah, that concludes this video. We're done. You just set up your basic VPS server. Now you can do whatever you want with it. If you want to run a live stream server or a web server, or whatever, it's your choice. Go right ahead. There's lots of guides on the internet available. So you should be good. This was actually a preparation for a new video that I'm making, and it should come out really soon. And it's on how to set up a live stream server using Nginx and HLS, including certificates, so you can live stream over a secured connection. So that should be good. This was the preparation for it, where I ended today. That's where I'll start off in the next video. If you like this one, you should check that one out also. Don't forget to give me a thumbs up and subscribe. You should really subscribe. Thanks. See you next time. Bye-bye.